Improving human eyesight. How synthetic eyes are in our future. You might think synthetic eyes are science fiction, but they already exist. A team of researchers from Hong Kong developed a synthetic electrochemical eye in 2020. It might have rudimentary capabilities as of yet, but the progress of science is unrelenting, and future versions might one day surpass the optical qualities of the human eye. But let's slow down for a moment, because this topic can get quite complex. We can't just jump into talking about synthetic eyes without understanding what makes human eyes so incredible, and how they compare to modern cameras. Once we've discussed the different strengths and weaknesses of each, we'll have enough background knowledge to understand why we might want to replace our eyes with synthetic versions. The human eye versus your camera. There is no camera on Earth that comes close to what the human eye can achieve. You might think you don't own a camera, but as long as you have eyes and a brain, you have one of the most advanced light-capturing devices on the planet. The human eye and a mirrorless camera operate on similar principles, simply because they both have to obey the laws of physics. In order to take a photo on my camera, something a photographer would refer to as an exposure, I have to manage the amount of light hitting my sensor. It can't be overexposed, or I'll lose details in the highlights, and it can't be underexposed, or I'll lose details in the shadows. The same is true of the human eye, but first we'll discuss the ways you would do that on a digital camera. There are only three ways you can control exposure in a light capturing system. Changing the shutter speed, how long light is hitting the sensor. Changing the aperture, how wide the opening of our lens is. Changing the ISO, also known as the gain of our signal. The shutter speed is how quickly the shutter is open during the exposure. The quicker the shutter speed, i.e. 1/8000th of a second, the less light hits the sensor, and the slower the shutter speed, i.e. 1/50th of a second, the more light that hits the sensor. The human eye has some natural motion blur to it, which would be roughly equivalent to a 1/50th shutter speed at 24 frames per second, the standard in cinema. The neurons in the retina and the human brain take 120 milliseconds to process an image, and this positional uncertainty leads to motion blur. 1. We're always seeing images that occurred slightly in the past, and the human brain is blending things together to form an image. A camera essentially takes a series of still frames to form a video with natural-looking movement, 24 of them per second. It's not real motion, it's simply the illusion of movement because the time period between frames is so small. The exact same principle is operating with a flipbook. There are no actual moving figures on each page. They're all stationary, but we have different positions on each page, and that gives the illusion that there is movement. The human brain doesn't operate that way. It has the ability to capture true motion, without splitting anything into frames. This is one advantage that the human eye has over cameras. Its weakness, though, is that it can't change its shutter speed to have a different exposure, so one of the main ways a light capturing system controls light is now taken out of the equation. Evolution came up with a solution to that problem, and it's called the pupil. In order for photons to hit the sensor of a camera, they need to pass through a small opening called an aperture. In the dark, you need a large opening to get enough light in your sensor, i.e. an f/1.4 lens, and in bright daylight you might make this opening small in order to control exposure, i.e. setting your camera to f/16. The human eye can control this opening using muscles in the iris, the colored part of your eye. When there is a lot of light, there is the constriction response, where sphincter muscles around the iris cause it to contract. If we are in a darker area, however, there is a dilation response, where the pupil opens up and allows for more light to hit the retina. This is collectively called the pupillary light reflex, which is controlled by a series of neurons that form a circuit between the retina and the brain. Essentially, these are the wires of our biological camera that are smoothly changing our settings, with the ultimate goal of controlling exposure. A camera operates using electricity, but the human body uses an electrochemical signal instead. Neurons generate an electrical signal that travels the length of their axon and stimulates the release of various neurotransmitters, which form the chemical part of our signal. The muscles in the iris have receptors for different types of chemicals, and this can affect whether they open or close the pupil. So the human eye has a mechanism for controlling its aperture, but what happens if changing the pupil diameter doesn't give us enough light? After all, the pupil can only go so wide. In this case, we have to resort to our last option, which is boosting the sensitivity of our light capturing sensor. The final way of controlling exposure on a camera is the ISO. Essentially, this magnifies the signal so you can shoot in the dark, but it also introduces noise into your image, so it's typically a last resort. The human visual system also has a similar way to boost the visual signal in areas of low light. If merely opening the pupil doesn't provide enough light, it can change the sensitivity of the photoreceptor cells, allowing you to see better in the dark. This is called adaptation, and it's just another way the human eye controls exposure. This is all just a complicated and long-winded way of stating that the human visual system has similar properties to a camera, with a sensor, circuits, aperture control, and motion blur, just using different specialized cells instead of electricity. The principles of optics are the same between them, but there are some things that the human eye just does better. What makes the human eye so special? The human visual system is truly a magnificent product of evolution, and many of us take it for granted. None of us really have to think about what we want to focus on, our visual systems just take care of it. You don't have to adjust the aperture of your pupil, your reflex circuits have that handled. All of the difficult settings that need to be adjusted in a camera are handled automatically, and the only thing you have to worry about is what you want to look at. This is likely because manually changing settings on the fly will get you eaten by the nearest predator. It's really the processor in our biological light capturing system that really sets us apart from a digital camera. The human brain doesn't just interpret a two-dimensional image, but it allows for vision in three dimensions. The curved surface of the retina can only receive a 2D image, but the brain then converts this to a 3D representation of the world. It isn't just passively receiving information, it's making reasonable guesses about what's there, and using past experience to form interpretations of objects. Our visual system actually has more of a dual process than anything. We're often taught that the retina simply receives visual information and relays this information passively to the brain. But the retina itself actively filters information within its cellular layers, doing some pre-processing of information before it even gets to the brain, too. It's also taking information that's hitting many different photoreceptors and converging the signal onto a single ganglion cell, which then outputs it to the brain. So instead of receiving a bunch of unnecessary information, the brain receives an organized, clean, pre-processed signal. This whole process might be slow in comparison to a digital camera, but the additional time it takes is part of the reason why it's a far superior light capturing system. Many digital cameras have filters placed on the sensor to clean up the image. A common one is an anti-aliasing filter, which prevents fine lines from causing moiré, an ugly artifact that tends to appear most commonly on clothing. This multicolored artifacting is sometimes difficult to remove in post, and AA filters sometimes don't even completely prevent the problem. The human visual system, on the other hand, has little to no aliasing. Sometimes visual illusions will cause neurons in our brains to freak out with fine lines, but in everyday life, our brains have almost perfect control of aliasing. Another artifact commonly encountered by photographers is something called chromatic aberration, also known as purple fringing. As light passes through a lens, it bends, and our ultimate goal is to get all of the wavelengths of that point of light to focus on the same exact spot. In every single lens designed by humans, there is chromatic aberration, which appears as a purple outline around the subject in high contrast scenes. It typically is at its worst when you're shooting towards a bright source of light. Sometimes there are green aberrations, and other times blue, but no matter what color it is, chromatic aberration is something you want to avoid and minimize when designing any lens. It can be relatively easily removed in editing software, but it's annoying at times, and certain types of aberrations can't be easily dealt with. The human visual system has no chromatic aberration. When's the last time you saw a purple outline around your friend? Probably never. This means that the human eye is focusing all wavelengths of light onto a single point on the retina, all across the visual field. In my eyes, no pun intended, that means that the human visual system has the greatest lens that has ever existed on Earth. There is not a single human-made lens that doesn't have chromatic aberration, never mind the litany of other artifacts that can come up when you try to minimize this issue. Almost non-existent with the human visual system. Chromatic aberration, absent in the human visual system. Longitudinal chromatic aberration, essentially the same, but you have fringing both before and after the point of focus. Absent in the human visual system. Distortion. Many wide-angle lenses have this fisheye effect where lines become skewed, Things in the center look larger than they actually are, and things towards the edge of the frame are stretched. The human eye has a 120 to 140 degree ultrawide field of view, with no distortion. And it's rectilinear, which means it maintains straight vertical lines, something that is rare with human-designed lenses. Not only that, but it like it's a 22mm lens that has the perspective of a 50mm lens. There is no equivalent in digital photography for this. I could take a panorama with 50mm lens and get a similar effect, but that might require stitching 20 photos together in Lightroom. I could take a photo of the moon with a 22mm lens, which has a similar field of view to the human eye, and our subject will be incredibly small in the frame. Yet, when you look at the moon with your eyes, it appears quite large, as if it was taken with a 50mm lens. That's because of the paradoxical properties of the human eye. It's both ultrawide and telephoto at the same time, which is an absolutely mind-blowing capability. Ghosting, flaring. A bright light source will sometimes cause the lens to flare, which appears as a colorful spot or streak on the image. It's caused by either the diffraction, or spreading out, of light as it passes through the lens, or a reflection on the inside surface of the glass. This is sometimes a desirable effect, and many photographers and filmmakers will purposefully use a vintage lens with a lot of flaring just to get that visual effect. But it can sometimes be distracting, which is why lens makers coat the glass in anti-reflective coatings to minimize this effect. The human visual system has very little diffraction, and only a minimal amount of flaring. There is none of the bright green, ghosting, spots that you'll see in photos that are shot towards the sun. Chromatic aberration, aka, coma. This is not to be confused with chromatic aberration, which is where one color isn't focused on the same spot as others. Coma is where you get a comet-looking point of light on the edge of your frame. It's something commonly seen in astrophotography, and it's a large reason why astrophotographers will pay extraordinary sums of money to acquire a lens that minimizes coma. This aberration is absent in the human visual system. To the human eye, stars in the sky look like points of light even at the far edges of your peripheral vision. If someone has a corneal abrasion, however, a scratch on the outer surface on the eye, it is possible to get some chromatic aberration. But this is a rare effect only seen in people with damage to their eyes, and corneal abrasions can also heal, unlike the surface of a glass lens element. And amazingly, even if someone has some coma from their cornea, the internal structures of the eye can compensate for this to minimize chromatic aberration. That's not to say that the human eye doesn't suffer from any aberrations or issues. It absolutely does. As we get older, the shape, position, and curvature of the cornea and lens tend to change, which shifts the plane of focus. The chromatic aberration that I mentioned before tends to get worse with age. There are issues with astigmatism, where one eye is focusing on a different plane than another, something that I have, which tends to feel like your eyes are fighting for focus with each other. Or sometimes your eyes will focus before the retina, nearsightedness, or behind the retina, farsightedness, which causes the image to become blurry. This also gets worse with age. But in a young and healthy human, there is very little aberration. It's incredible just how perfect the human eye is, right out of the box. The metaphorical box, that is. If we take a healthy human eye and compare it to cinema lenses used to film Academy Award-winning films, there is no contest, the human eye is superior in almost every single way. And that's not just because of the lens itself, or even the retina, but the real game changer is the brain. Let's break down what the brain is doing to process visual information. The brain receives information from retinal ganglion cells. This is actually an upside-down image from the retina, and then it flips it back to form an upright image of the world. This is strange to think about, but it's just because the lens flips the image. It takes the upside-down visual information from the retina and begins processing it in the visual cortex, located at the back of the brain. Our primary visual cortex has a map of the entire visual field, organized into areas that correspond to spots on the retina. So at this stage, our brain is simply trying to receive information from the retina in a highly systematic and organized way. It then begins to analyze basic shapes, lines, contrast, and movement to form a general understanding of what it's seeing. This process is called bottom-up processing in psychology. The cells in primary visual cortex are all highly specialized, analyzing their particular area of the visual field, or looking at the data to see if there's a line with a particular orientation, or an area of contrast that could indicate an edge. The brain is just starting to form an understanding of what it's receiving. This information is then sent to higher order areas for analysis of movement, color, and processing for facial features. The brain is starting to build a higher level understanding of the information. The visual information then moves further up the chain, where it is compared to our conceptual idea of what an object is. A series of lines in a particular orientation might indicate that we're looking at a chair, and it's in these higher level areas of the brain's visual system that we'll start analyzing whole objects based on our past experience. The prefrontal lobes then receive this information, and it's compared with our current goals. Is this something that is relevant to what I'm doing right now? Is this visual information something that is related to my goals? If so, your frontal lobes will pay attention, and it will send instructions back down to the lower visual areas. This is how our expectations can sometimes affect how we see things, through a process we call top-down processing. Our brains don't just see the world, they interpret the world. And that means that sometimes they are wrong, or biased towards seeing something that's not necessarily there. Any visual information relevant to your survival is sent to your fight or flight system. If your visual system detects that you're staring down a bear, it'll pump adrenaline into your body, get your heart rate going, and send this information back up to the higher level areas of the brain for a decision on what to do. At a certain point, visual information becomes mixed with auditory information, tactile information, and other sensory data. A small area in the midbrain called the superior colliculus receives visual information from both the retina and primary visual cortex, and integrates it with other sensory modalities. 5. The signal becomes multimodal, a form of information that has no bearing on where it originated. This likely allows the brain to gain an even deeper understanding of what is happening, because all of the senses are mixing together and being analyzed as one unified sense. 120 milliseconds after the light hit our retina, we have conscious awareness of what we've seen. This means that what you're seeing is always a little bit in the past. It is not possible to see something when it actually happens, because there isn't enough time for you to become aware of it. In comparison to a digital camera, 120 milliseconds is extremely slow. That's because wires can travel at almost the speed of light, 300 million meters per second, and a neuron can typically only conduct at a maximum of 120 meters per second. And that's only the fastest myelinated neurons, the human body. Most other neurons operate at well below that speed. So the wires of a digital camera can conduct information at 2.5 million times quicker than a neuron can, and that's only a conservative estimate based on the fastest neurons. The presence of slower neurons means that it is probably well beyond 2.5 million times quicker. And yet, even with its massive speed advantage, a digital camera only presents a series of frames, not true motion. In most cases, it can only read pixels on the sensor from top to bottom, leading to rolling shutter, skewed lines when there is fast motion. And a camera also records a 2D image, it doesn't create a 3D environment complete with an understanding of objects in relation to your goals. While the process might be slower with the human visual system, it provides a far more complex interpretation of the visual information. What about synthetic eyes? The incredible optics of the human eye come at a price. The sharpness of our vision tends to degrade with age, with our lenses becoming more opaque. This scatters the light that would normally pass right through to the retina, and introduces more aberrations in what we see. 14. The human lens also loses elasticity over time, shifting the point of focus away from the retina. Additionally, the cornea tends to cloud over with age, causing blinding cataracts. There are countless visual disorders that can arise as we get older, and it's just a product of having biological cells with ever-degrading DNA. It is a shame that such an optical masterpiece as the human eye has a temporary lifespan for optimal functioning. A digital camera has no such concerns, beyond the accumulation of dust and mold within its elements. But what if we could merge the advantages of having a biological eye with the longevity of a digital camera? A team of researchers at Hong Kong University recently developed a synthetic, electrochemical eye that has a 3D artificial retina. 6. They say that this artificial retina is made of an array of nanowire light sensors which mimic the photoreceptors in human retinas. The path towards merging technology with the human body has already been set in motion, and it will end up in a place that seems like science fiction. In their paper, The researchers say that in the near future their bionic eye will allow for superhuman sharpness, infrared vision, and night vision. The components within the eye also require no battery power, because each sensor acts as its own mini solar cell. If we take this idea and extrapolate it even further, we might eventually have bionic zoom lenses that allow us to see things from an unimaginable distance away. Imagine having a 400mm zoom on your eye, so that you can see exactly what is going on from the other side of a football stadium. Or perhaps we will be able to easily interchange our eyes for new ones when technology progresses. Instead of being stuck with the same eyes your whole life, you can purchase upgrades. I would personally pay for a pair of eyes with any of the following: a curved sensor to mimic the structure of the human retina, 10mm-100mm zoom lens, so that I can have both a wide field of view and a zoom if I need it, night vision, obviously, ultraviolet, infrared vision, so that I can see what bees and rattlesnakes see, internal recording so that anything I see can be played back. The same sort of idea as a dash cam on your car. If anything happens, you have a record of it. The ability to take photos with my eyes. How much lazier can a photographer get? Self-diagnosis capabilities. It would be useful to know if there's anything wrong with my lenses, or if my synthetic retina needs a repair. Wireless capability. How cool would it be to connect your eyes up to your social media? It would give a whole new meaning to seeing something through another's eyes. There will almost certainly be people in the future vlogging through their synthetic eyes. And people will pay to watch it. Filters. It would be interesting to be able to color grade your experience of the world, in the same way you would edit a photo. It might not be an accurate representation of the world, but there would certainly be a market for enhancing the visual experience of the world. I expect there will also be filters developed to smooth out skin using artificial intelligence. Don't want to see your friend's blemishes. The processor in your eye will do the work to remove that. Augmented reality. There have been previous attempts to create glasses that will augment our experience of the world, Google Glass being one of them. The problem is that they aren't exactly stylish. If you had the same features built right into your synthetic eyes, you could see a HUD of the weather, a map to your next destination, or even reviews of each store you pass. It would open up an entirely new world of human experience, and further our integration with technology. It's a scary possibility, but one that is probably inevitable. It seems like we've ventured into the territory of science fiction, but these are all real possibilities, given the rapid progression of technology over the previous few decades. I don't believe that synthetic eyes will be using glass as their lens elements. You don't want to break your eyes by jumping up and down or playing sports. There needs to be a way to make the elements in the synthetic eye durable enough to withstand the forces of everyday life. It is likely that the solution will come in the form of a liquid lens. The smartphone manufacturer Xiaomi has recently revealed that their newest device will utilize a liquid lens. Instead of using glass, the element is a thin layer of liquid. A charge is applied to the sides of the liquid, and it changes shape, allowing the optical properties to shift. What would be the advantage of using a liquid lens for a synthetic eye? Reliability. In order to focus, elements within a lens need to move. That means components are going to wear out eventually. But if your only moving part is a liquid, that means it can potentially withstand billions of these little movements without degrading. Reduced aberrations. In normal camera lenses, you can get something called spherical aberration, which is where light rays from the periphery of the frame don't converge correctly, and so your image becomes soft when the lens is at its widest aperture, i.e. f/1.8. A liquid lens can function to minimize this spherical aberration, and it can also deal with the chromatic aberration mentioned earlier, 8. There is also an additional benefit of using liquid lenses, and that is minimized field curvature, where the plane of focus is curved as opposed to straight. Extremely fast focusing. It takes a relatively long time for a piece of glass to move within a lens, even with more advanced linear motors. The latest linear motors from Sony still take 100 milliseconds to focus. A liquid lens has no such moving parts, and therefore it has the potential to focus extremely fast, which is something you would need out of your eyes. The current liquid lenses used in manufacturing are able to focus in under 15 milliseconds, which is more than 6 times faster than using glass. The ability to change focal length. A liquid lens can dynamically change its focal length in milliseconds. This means there's no need to have multiple lenses in order to have a wide angle in a telephoto. A single lens can give you all of the perspectives you require. This is ideal if we're designing synthetic eyes, because we probably need to keep the size down to fit it in your eye socket. Energy efficiency. It takes a lot of energy to move glass, but very little energy to change the electrical charge on the edge of a liquid lens. Since current bionic eyes are using small solar cells in their photoreceptors, this means a liquid lens would be the perfect match for the relatively low power output of a solar-powered system. Ultimately, that means no need to switch out batteries for your eye. It is for those reasons that I believe future synthetic eyes will have liquid lenses. It allows for superior optical quality that is far closer to the properties of the human eye, along with smaller size, faster focusing, better reliability, and lower power consumption. There is no reason not to use a liquid lens, except for limitations in current technology. But technology will continue to progress, until we have liquid lenses in our smartphones, and maybe even our eyes one day. We've discussed how to get the best optical quality in a synthetic eye, but how will the brain be able to make sense of the data? The brain has evolved to receive neural impulses from a biological retina, so how can it possibly change its wiring to accommodate for something made of silicone? The human brain has a property called plasticity, which means it can dynamically change its connections. This can happen on the level of synapses, but it can also occur with whole brain areas. The more you play piano, the more cortical real estate that gets allocated to motor areas controlling your fingers. Our brains are constantly remapping themselves in response to the environment and external stimuli. If we put an electrode array on a blind person's tongue that responds to photons, their brain will eventually figure out that it's receiving visual information just from a different source than it's used to. 13. And incredibly, the cortical areas for vision start to remap themselves in order to make sense of this new information from the tongue. It might sound unbelievable, but after a while, someone who's completely blind can use this device and simply stick out their tongue to see. It's a rudimentary form of vision that only really gives them the ability to see shapes, but they can see, and their brains remap themselves to do so. The sensory information from a synthetic retina will be much more readily assimilated by the brain. We're not using a completely different sensory modality, such as tactile information from the tongue device, to create a visual signal, we're just substituting a biologically generated visual system for a synthetic version. I would expect the brain would rapidly undergo neuroplastic changes to welcome this new replacement set of eyes. There are many horrible diseases of the eye that can significantly affect people's quality of life. To be able to see the beauty of the world is one of the greatest gifts evolution has bestowed upon us. And one day, we will be able to transcend the evolutionary game and upgrade our own bodies. The human eye is magnificent, but it has limits to its resolution and lifespan. There are no such limits for the capabilities of a synthetic eye, other than the pace of technological innovation. It will perhaps start with synthetic eyes, because vision is such a crucial part of having a good quality of life, but I have a feeling we won't stop there. If we find that we like our new superhuman vision, then why not superhuman hearing? Why wouldn't we replace our weak human arms with a synthetic alternative? It will be a strange future when we start modifying our biology with technology, but it is perhaps an inevitable step humanity will take, given that it is so difficult to correct the problems of biology. I'm good with my eyes for now, but the advantages of a synthetic version become truly irresistible. I might just turn myself into a cyborg.